Good evening. Pastor Ben challenged us on Palm Sunday to not just recall the events of Holy Week, but to try to embody the story itself. And so as we continue our three-day service, the Triduum, which began last night and culminates in Easter, you'll have a different opportunity tonight to embody the story in a different way. The service is divided up into seven segments, each focusing on a different theme of the Passion. You'll hear accounts from Scripture read, while at the same time seeing that embodied by our youth up front. Then I'll lead us in a time of prayer, followed by a period of silence for personal reflection. During those times, I invite you to ask yourself, where am I in the story? After the silence, the lyrics of our hymns will take us into the next segment. The service will end in whatever darkness we may have at that point. We'll end singing together. And then after the last song, after the last hymn, we'll exit, we'll depart in silence. But feel free to remain as long as you wish. So if you're in the moment, if you're thinking about something, you don't have to rush that moment, but you're welcome to depart at any time from then on. Before we begin, let me just preface with this. Each and every one of you gathered here tonight is loved by God and lives in the light of forgiveness. Every single Sunday, after you have confessed your sins, the pastor speaks absolution, which includes the words, Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his son to die for you, and for his sake, forgives you all of your sins. Our focus on tonight is what it took for that to be true for you. With that, we rise. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Tonight, as we recall the events leading up to and including the crucifixion of our Lord on Good Friday, our focus is centered around seven words: betrayal, denial, aloneness, accusation, suffering, crucifixion, and death. We call it Good Friday in light of the truth that Sunday is coming. But for tonight, you may be seated for our hymn.
Thank you. betrayal. Now, when Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came up to him with an alabaster flask of very expensive ointment, and she poured it on his head as he reclined at the table. And when the disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, "Why this waste? For this could have been sold for a large sum and given to the poor." But Jesus, aware of this, said to them, "Why do you trouble the woman? For she has done a beautiful thing to me. For you always have the poor with you, but you will not always have me. In pouring this ointment on my body, she has done it to prepare me for burial. Truly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her." Then one of the 12, whose name was Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, "What will you give me if I deliver him over to you?" And they paid him 30 pieces of silver. From that moment, he sought an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying, "Where will you have us prepare for you to eat the Passover?" He said, "Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'" And the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he reclined at table with the 12. And as they were eating, he said, "Truly, I say to you, one of you will betray me." And they were very sorrowful and began to say to him one after another, "Is it I, Lord?" He answered, "He who has dipped his hand in the dish with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born."
Dearest Jesus, you have given us the most precious gift of all. Holy Spirit, help us ponder anew what we might give in return. What act of worship or service would cost us dearly that we would honor you so? In what ways have you blessed me that I might be foolishly extravagant in the ways that I live for you? How might I live my life in such a way as to anoint you as king rather than for burial? As I sit here pondering Judas' betrayal for 30 pieces of silver, the price of compensation for a dead slave, I don't have to ask, "Is it I, Lord?" I already know that it is. In sober recognition, I realize that there are many times when I have betrayed you for far less, where I have lived how I have wanted to, or where I have selfishly made other things more important than you. Search my heart. Reveal to me where I may be doing that right now. But also, let me know that you still love me, that you still died for Judas's sins, and you still died for mine too, even the times when I have betrayed you.
I resolve to know nothing but you crucified. Somehow in this room right now, it is enough. The weight of the world, too much for the souls of men, but somehow you hold it all upon the cross. Calvary's enough. Calvary's enough. When I know nothing, when I know too much, what I choose to know right now is Calvary's enough. You resolved to die, scarlet flowing from your hands inside. Covenant is sealed and ratified. You knew the cost. As the darkness fell and the temple curtain torn, the death I deserved, you made yours upon the cross. Calvary's enough. Calvary. Shouts from the cross. The world is broken, but all is not lost. Because of Jesus and what he has done on Calvary, it's always enough. But I know this much. Oh, Calvary is more than enough.
Aloneness. And they went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he took with him Peter and James and John, began to be greatly distressed and troubled. And he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch." Going a little farther, he fell on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me. Yet not what I will, but what you will." And he came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again, he went and prayed, saying the same words. And again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to answer him. And he came the third time and said to them, Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners.
Dearest Jesus, very few people are ready or desiring to die. You didn't welcome death either. Scripture doesn't use the word depressed, but sorrowful unto death is how you felt. Such anguish you felt, and all you wanted was for your followers to pray for you and with you. How many times have you commanded me to pray and I don't? How many times have you stated the true power of prayer and yet I treat it like a last resort? That is, if I can even stay awake long enough or remember even to do it. You asked the Father for what you desired, but ultimately submitted to his will, not your own. How many times, Lord, when I have prayed, has it only been for my will alone to be granted? Father, you have a purpose for my life and for those around me. You know what is best for me, even better than I do. Help me, O Spirit, to be submissive in my prayers, to pray like that. Help me to be a good friend by taking prayer seriously on behalf of others, that you wouldn't have to ask me two or three times or more to take the battle to my knees. Help me to pray for more than just myself. Help me to pray for you, or rather to pray that your will would be done and not just what I want from you. Thank you, Lord, for the times in my life when I am alone and you never sleep. You never leave me. Thank you, Jesus, for submitting to the Father's will for me. Help me to respond by doing the same.
Accusation. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the brook Kidron, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "Of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the band of soldiers and their captain and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him. First, they led him to Annas. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had advised the Jews that it would be expedient that one man should die for the people. Now the chief priest and the whole council were seeking testimony against Jesus to put him to death. But they found none, for many bore false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. And some stood up and bore false witness against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.'" Yet even about this, their testimony did not agree.
Dearest Lord Jesus, the garden was a place where you went often with your disciples. It was familiar. In my life, there are times when I can feel so familiar, so comfortable with you, that I don't hesitate like Peter to lash out, to react to situations at hand, sometimes with good intentions, sometimes just reacting. Sometimes my actions harm myself or others. Jesus, sometimes I'm the one who comes looking for you. When I'm angry that you didn't answer something in the way I thought, or a situation didn't work out the way that I wanted it to, and frustration and disappointment. When you haven't lived up to my idea of what God should be or do, I can sometimes put myself in the place of judge and jury. I can act as if you are the one on trial. But in those moments, you gently ask me, whom do I seek? It's as if you are saying to my very soul, are you seeking me or just a God of your own design? Lord, as your disciples, we don't always agree. When I've asked the wrong questions, when I've reacted in haste, when I've lashed out, when I've been to blame, you took all of the responsibility. You accepted all of the accusations in my place. You accepted it fully and asked that I be let go. When my heart wants to lash out or flee, what would you show me in this moment? What have you accomplished silently accepting my accusations that I can turn over to you right now? Help me, O Spirit, to be honest with myself and with Jesus, to own up to the things that I would sooner cast blame for.
Denial. Simon Peter followed Jesus. So did another disciple. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he entered with Jesus into the court of the high priest, but Peter stood outside the door. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the servant girl who kept watch at the door and brought Peter in. The servant girl at the door said to Peter, "You also are not one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered him, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said these things, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered him, "If what I said is wrong, bear witness about the wrong. But if what I said is right, why do you strike me?" Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest.
Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am in distress. My eye is wasted from grief, my soul and my body also. For my life is spent with sorrow and my years with sighing. My strength fails because of my iniquity and my bones waste away. Because of all of my adversaries, I have become a reproach, especially to my neighbors, and an object of dread to my acquaintances. Those who see me in the streets flee from me. I have been forgotten like one who is dead. I have become like a broken vessel. For I hear the whispering of many, tear on every side, as they scheme together against me, as they plot to take my life. But I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God.
Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. So they said to him, "You also are not one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Peter again denied it, and at once a rooster crowed.
Dearest Lord Jesus, every one of us here tonight is a follower of yours. And every single one of us, in some way or another, by things we have said, done, or not done, directly or indirectly, denied being your follower. Those who see us don't always see attitudes or behaviors that portray you as Lord of our life or living for you. Like Peter, I have said, "Not me, Lord, I'll never do that. I'll die before I fall away." Such boldness, such conviction. But how many times have I chosen sleeping in or convenience over you, much less death? I'm no different than Peter. I'd like to think that I would stick by you no matter what, but there are times in my own life that I already see that I haven't always done that. And yet, out of love, you faced a mockery of a trial without me and for me. The rooster doesn't have to crow for me to know my sinfulness. And yet, like Peter, you still call me to follow you even yet. You still ask, "Do you love me?" You still desire to stand with me. You not only associate with me, but know me better than anyone else in this entire world.
Suffering. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning. They themselves did not enter the governor's headquarters so that they would not be defiled but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken, to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called to Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priest have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting, that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." And Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" They cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now, Barabbas was a robber.
Who has believed what they heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes, we are healed.
Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man!" When the chief priest and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law he ought to die, because he has made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified.
Dearest Lord Jesus, King of the universe, you stood before the rulers of this world and submitted to their authority, their false claims, their false truths for me. When given opportunities to avoid it or lessen it, you said nothing so that I could be part of your kingdom, so that I might know the truth. The truth is that there are times when we stand before those in power in this world and we feel wrongly accused. There are times when the kingdom of this world does not align with the kingdom of heaven and we feel that tension. And there are times when we too must endure suffering in this life. I can be so focused on myself. It can be difficult to remember that you suffered, Jesus. The very curse of the sin of our obedience was that thorns would infest the ground. Those same thorns would then be woven into a mock crown and thrust down upon your brow. Every one of the drops of blood that ran down your beautiful face should have been mine. In times of hurt, remind me that it fails in comparison of the price that you paid. Remind me of the truth that sin and Satan have been defeated and that ultimately even death itself will not be something that has claim to us. That even now you are seated on the throne, ruling and reigning for me. Strengthen me in times of adversity that I may honor your suffering when I am called to follow. Grant that by my actions or my words, I would robe you with righteousness and not mockery. That you were stricken, smitten, and afflicted for me and all that I must endure.
crucifixion. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name, and they compelled this man to carry his cross. When they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his garments among them by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And over his head they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." So also the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and then we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he desires him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'"
Dearest Lord Jesus, you were nailed to a tree that was created by your very own hands, pinned there by your very own creatures. You who are arrayed in splendor and majesty were stripped of everything, dying with nothing, not even the clothes on your back. You who created life itself endured the most cruel form of execution known to mankind in death. You who were surrounded by cherubim and seraphim now hang between two brutal robbers, innocence becoming guilt. You did not deliver yourself in order to deliver us. The soldiers divided your garments by a game of chance, but our salvation hung in the balance according to the sure and certain plan of the Father, so that no nail, no guilt, no sentence would keep us from your kingdom. What are those nails which you have loosed that still cling to us? What sin have you exposed and crucified that we need to leave on the cross? Who do I crucify as guilty that you have already stood for? Where do I cast lots in life to try and get what is yours instead of entrusting in your goodness and mercy? That by your death we would trust you in this life.
death. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. It was now about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, while the sun's light failed. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last.
Since it was the day of preparation, so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place, that the scripture might be fulfilled, "Not one of his bones will be broken." And again, another scripture says, "They will look on him whom they have pierced." After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there.
The very author of life has died. A sinner's death. That sinners sentenced to die might have life. Betrayal, denial, aloneness, accusation, suffering, crucifixion, and death. Jesus endured it all for you. We call it Good Friday in light of the truth that Sunday is coming. But for tonight, we focus on our sinfulness and the death that was paid so that we could have eternal life.